All right, so I am very, very honored to introduce our speaker today. Karim Nagy is a native Egyptian drummer, DJ, composer, and folk dancer. He performs and teaches all over the world. I had the extreme pleasure of taking a workshop with him recently, and I can tell you that he is entertaining. He is, you will learn things that you had no idea you didn't know, and that you wanted to know. And I really can't say enough about him. So I am just going to let him do his thing. And I'm going to tell you that he has a website. Please check it out. He has lots and lots of music and instructional videos and DVDs. You can learn to play music. You can learn all about rhythms. You can learn anything you want to know. About
music. You make it sound so broad, you know? It's like, I'll solve all your problems. Thank you, Mary, thank you. I will solve all your problems in every topic, as long as it involves a drum. So first of all, 15 years ago today was my very first presentation to a third grade school. And that means any, first of all, it was my first presentation to a public school. And what it was that was about a week after 9/11. So 9/11 happened. Now I'm Arab, Muslim, American, and living in the United States. And it was a very scary time for everybody. It was doubly scary for me. First of all, I was afraid of terrorism, like everybody is. You know, bombs are non-discriminant. Bombs will detonate anywhere. They do not ask first what your belief is or who you're aligned with. You know, I'm in danger like anyone else. But also, by being a Muslim, I was afraid of a backlash. I was afraid that people would also think that somehow I was complicit, or somehow that I endorsed it, or that I felt that, you know, that this was a good thing or whatever, or they wouldn't even ask. So I was doubly scared. So I hid in my basement in Watertown, Massachusetts. And over there, the basements, they're only like half underground anyway. So like I could see out the window. So I don't think I was really safe. So about a week after 9/11, or, you know, I think it was almost the 19th of September, a friend of mine, who was a grade school teacher, said that she had one of her children there who was an Arab American, somebody who had, you know, had Muhammad in their name, and was getting harassed by the other children regarding 9/11. This is a third grade, what is that, 9 years old, I think. And so they asked me to come to the school to advocate for her. And what I really realized is that people just didn't know anything about Arabs or Muslims at that time, other than political events, other than what they saw on TV. And it's very parallel to racism in general that we see around the United States, which is lack of familiarity brings stereotyping and prejudice. So my goal became, well, I don't want to be yet another person to walk around and preaching Islam and politics or whatever. What I thought was to help people with familiarity, to help people know more about Arab and Muslim culture. That would help them have a more balanced view, anybody to have a more balanced view about what we were like as people, and then to start to see us as human, and then not be afraid when they hear a political, when they see something political happen or some tragedy, to not automatically assume that every Arab or Muslim in America or all over the world is complicit or endorses these things. As a matter of fact, it's far, far less than 1%. As a matter of fact, it is far smaller than the total crime that happens in the United States. It is just a very, very visible one. So familiarity, that's my goal, rather than preach. So what I do is I go around to schools all over the United States and I show them Arabic culture through music. So, I mean, as this room is already perfectly decorated with orange and purple, there's not much else I can do to help it. But for example, you have various types of fabrics that people are unfamiliar with. A lot of people have seen this, for example, people wearing them. You can buy it at the Army Navy store. You used to be able to buy it at Urban Outfitters. People don't even know that this is a kufiya. This is a Palestinian, Jordanian, Iraqi headscarf that people all over the Arab world all the time. Things with geometric patterns, which people so flatteringly call arabesque. So this is what we call, you know, this specifically is called a chayameh. It's fabric laid on top of other fabric. But the whole idea of these geometric patterns, floral patterns that we see all the time in design right now, this is actually also something very Arabic, like we have here. But these things tend to not be as popular as music, because everybody listens to music, everybody enjoys rhythm. So when I show things from the musical side, people tend to soften their hearts towards Arabs and Muslims. So here's the very first thing that I will show you. This is called a duff. So if, well, you can write it in English, D-U-F-F. And anytime there's a wedding, anytime there's a birthday party, anytime there's a religious celebration, you will see this instrument come out. So this is an instrument of celebration. This is an instrument for engaging in some like social holiday or some popular event, the duff. First of all, it's made entirely by hand. We take a piece of wood, hold the wood over like boiling water, and the boiling water makes a steam, burns your hands, burns your hair off, and then you bend it while it's soft into a complete circle. And we take a skin of an animal. And if that sounds weird for you, I'll tell you, first, the animal lives a long, happy life, achieving all its personal goals, attaining self-actualization, dying with a smile on its face happily. And then we would take the skin off of that animal and put it on our second life, which is for the doof. So it could be a goat, it could be a cow, it could be a lamb. There's another option when I get to the smaller drums. And then we put often on the inside, like, it's like a snare, it's like a string that makes it vibrate each time. So it sort of makes a little extra effect. And then the final thing, well, I told you, because it's all about the people over there. No, it's just you. Celebration. So, of course, if I'm going to celebrate, I'm not going to go there when somebody's having a wedding and just go. Because they're supposed to be happy on their wedding, right? I mean, they're supposed to not have self-doubt and worry that this is a bad choice and that they're trapped in something for a long time. So instead, you know, rather than just do the job, we have to do something animated. The same thing for like a birthday. I mean, what if you're turning 30 and you've been 29 for so long and now you have this really bad feeling and then this drummer comes and plays boring? Well, then you'll really be upset about getting older. So this whole thing is all about, we have to do the acrobatics, dance around, because it's all part of the celebration. So here's an example of the duff. Thank you, everybody. Welcome. So first of all, who can tell me, how did I spin this duff? Does anyone have an idea? How did I spin it?
Trying to figure it out.
It's magic. Yes. See that? So first of all, put the thumb here, let go, hit, and catch. Hit and catch. And we do it on the beat, so I don't want to just be like, look, I can spin. And then continue and be like, look, I can do it again. So this is just trickery, you know, we have to do it on the beat. So it takes some mathematics. Two beats to go all the way around. So I'm counting to four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Just like this. I have to put it inside the music. It has this effect where it sort of spreads the sound all around, but even more importantly, gets people excited. I do it on your birthday. So you're excited on your birthday. So you're not worried about aging. I do it in your wedding. So you're excited about your wedding. So you don't feel trapped into a long-term engagement. I do it in a religious ceremony, so you don't feel like, oh, religion is imposed on me and this is, you know, this awful dogma that my parents gave me. No, religion has groove and you're happy. So this is part of the celebration of the Arab world. So again, you're all coming, I'm showing things about Arab and Muslim culture so that you can balance that with the things that you see on television. Okay, so for first of all, you're gonna watch BBC, you're going to listen to BBC this morning or CNN, and you're going to hear about the stabbings in Minneapolis. You're going to hear about a terrorist act in Manhattan and recently in New Jersey. They're not going to show you the doof or Karim going to schools or what we eat for breakfast or anything, the other 99.9%. Just such is the case with all people who are learning about a culture for the first time. So I'm trying to show you different things. Now, another thing that we have here in the Arab world, which you will see a parallel of in the United States, but a totally different function, is the tambourine. So for example, this is called riq. And the word riq, first of all, it's Arabic language, so we have our own language. We have letters that don't really, that sound a little different in English. First of all, our R's use the tongue. So like this would be called Bristol Community College, all right? And so this is riq, and the last letter is like a Q. The word riq comes from the Arabic word raqiq, raqiq or ra'iq, which means fine or thin. Why is it fine or thin? Because it's so thin, it's made from the skin of a fish. So I can hold this up to the light, and you can start to see scales and bones. So the fish lived a long, happy life, swimming as it willed, and then finally, after dying of self-actualization, then we skinned it, put it on the tambourine, and it had its entirely new life. Now, I'm gonna talk a little bit about the riq while I heat it. I have this heating pad, because you see it's very humid in here. So wetness with these skins, they start to get loose and expand. Just sort of like people do, I mean, when it's humid and you start to walk like this. So the same thing happens. Then there's other ones that have plastic where it just has the issue of sounding awful, but it stays firm. Now the riq, here's the difference. The tambourine in the United States is played by people who don't play any other instrument, but wanna be in the band and enjoy all these, you know, the lifestyle, get in the van and travel. Now, the Arabic riq is actually a classic music instrument, classical, which means that you go to school to learn it. You can get a university degree, a doctorate degree, after you convince your parents that that this is worthy of their money. This is a doctorate degree, PhD in the riq. It's the same process as, say, wanting to learn the violin, the piano, singing. It is a classical music instrument. It has sheet music and all of this. There's also people play it for folklore and fun and things like that, but it's different than what you would see in the United States. So this instrument is like a small duff with a fish skin, and then cymbals put all the way around. So let me play you an example of the riq. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Is this a wreck?
No. No.
Only one opinion by one very certain person. Is this a wreck or is this some other instrument with some other name? Who believes this is some other instrument? Let's pretend that we're in third grade like I went 15 years ago. Raise your hand if you think this is some other instrument with some other name. It's politically and socially incorrect to ever call this a wreck. We're being disingenuous and politically incorrect. Very good. Who believes this is a wreck? Excellent. Who does not have opinions on such obscure topics? Good. Never. This is a wreck. It's exactly the same instrument, all right? This one is made of wood and fish and skin. This one is made of metal and plastic. Otherwise, same size, same general concept. Now we made this one, this is a modern version. So this would be the same like you had like an electric guitar versus an acoustic guitar, electric piano versus, except it's not electric, it's made from metal. So I'm going to play this one for you, then I want some of you to tell me, which one do you prefer? And we'll learn all about culture, preference, and ageism at that moment. Wood and fish. Who prefers metal and plastic? Right. Can you tell me why do you prefer metal and plastic? And there's no right or wrong. We're learning about opinions here.
It sounds more clear and more modern.
Sure. Who here preferred wood and fish? Tell us why. Yes, please.
The other one sounds like a toy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, very good. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Sure, different tone. Same technique, but different tone. Anybody else, which one did you prefer? Tell us why. Back row. The one, the fish skin one, right? Excellent. Anybody else? Yes.
I prefer the other one. I felt more of the vibration go through my body.
Okay, okay. Anybody else share his thought about metal and plastic? Anyone? Metal? Heavy? Yes.
I prefer them both like for different reasons. One that's metal and plastic has much of a higher tone.
Yeah.
One that has more of a deeper, richer tone.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, both of them have the same technique. It's a very good explanation. This one, oh, point to the one that's older. Point to the one that is more modern. Point to the one that is made by hand. Point to the one that is made by a machine. Point to the one that's fragile. I have to be careful with it. Point to the one that I could leave it out all winter long, drive over it with my GMC American SUV, crush it, and it's going to sound exactly the same. This one. Now, that's the difference, is this is the modern version, because this one, it's a little quieter. It's harder to maintain. This one is durable. And see, our Arabic countries, the population increased and increased and increased. So when I was born over four decades ago, Egypt was about 35 million people, 40 million people. Now it's over 80 million people. And all the Arab world is the highest rate of population increase. That means more noise. That means fewer resources. That means we have to modernize our instruments out of things that would normally be thought of as garbage and that have become, you know, used as a regular instrument material now. And this is all the result of overpopulation and also the need to make a bigger sound because people are noisier and they don't want to wait and hear the classical instrument anymore. We're in this small environment and you're trapped here with me sweating and just doing whatever I ask you. So you're going to listen to the fish skin. But out there back in the Arab world, nobody will wait for it. They want to hear it and they want the higher pitched and more modern one. Now there's one instrument, however, that's endured all of that. First of all, before I continue to sweat, does anyone want to ask me a question? Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
What would be the difference in prices
for those? $295. $85. This one is made by a machine. This one is made by hand. That's the difference in price. But a lot of people preferred the wood one. I won't belabor this too more because you're all going to get bored with me. This is the older, authentic one. What would you rather have? A 2004 Chevy, what do they call it? Chevy Nova. Or would you rather have a 2016 Scion?
Neither.
They both stink, yeah. Okay, so you would rather walk. The truth is most people wouldn't prefer a new automobile or a newer house or a newer clothes, but the instruments, maybe they don't prefer the newer one. So music, actually, we get off of our track and we have different preferences because sometimes the older instruments do sound better. Now this instrument is cheap. You asked about price. 45 cents. 45 cents and they're made of brass. You pour the liquid brass into something that's this shape, and then they stay that shape. So then they're all kinds of different pitches, unfortunately, because it's an imperfect process. So you see, one is higher than the other, which means the higher one has less brass. And then I can make all the sounds. Well, I can hit them to the side. I can close them like this. I can hit them like this. I can hit them like this. Now, a lot of people would think this instrument is kind of rudimentary, you know what I mean? This sort of like monkey symbol, you wind it up and put it like this. This is a very advanced instrument, originally a religious instrument that became a dancing instrument. Now, the Arabic word for this is sajat. I'm going to ask you now to repeat all the Arabic words that we learned today. First one, my name, Karim. That means generous. Last name, Nagi. That, if you're going to say in classical Arabic, Naji. That means saved, salvaged. So religious I am. Then we have Duf. Can you say Duf? Rik. Sajat. It's five Arabic words. So this instrument is played, originally a religious instrument, is now a dance-oriented instrument for moving and playing at the same time. Thank you. Thank you. Do I have to be right-handed or left-handed to play this instrument?
Both-handed.
Ambidextrous, because you have to access the different pitches and then also use them for the direction that you're moving in. Like, say, if I go in this direction, I will lead with this hand. Now, what if I was only monodextrous? What would happen? I'd have to, like, go all the way out this door, up, back, into room 210 where we're supposed to, and then come all the way back here. That would end my lecture really quickly. So instead, we switch. And the primitive version is to not switch, but the advanced version is to be able to switch. So here's another instrument that looks simple, like the tambourine, like the duf, but they're actually quite advanced. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Are you in a box playing these things a lot?
Am I in a who or what?
I'm in the Boston Arab American Symphony Orchestra.
I'm a professional musician. I play these every day. I do lectures. I do concerts. I've traveled all over the world. I've performed in Guangzhou, China. I've performed in Zipiquirá, Colombia. I've performed in Leiden, the Netherlands. I've performed in every continent except except Australia, which will be in June, first time. So I've performed all over the world Arabic music constantly. I'm the orchestra. Much cheaper than the 50-person one. And music is enough for me, but actually I've thought of it as now it's much more important as a bigger context. Because people in the United States, especially and all over the world, more so with the ongoing terrorism problem, with the refugee crisis, with all of these political issues, we are a very feared group of people. I mean, you're all comfortable with me here in this room, laughing, we're doing music together, it's wonderful. That is, in general, not the impression that people have. The most of the time, people run out as soon as they can. So basically, I like to take this opportunity to relax people about the Arab world and relax Muslims, relax non-Muslims. It's especially because music is something kind of we could relate to. Usually we have fear of people that we are unfamiliar with, people that we don't have access to. So there was actually in 2011 a Gallup poll. So the Gallup is the people who poll to see like who are you likely to vote for in such an election if you live in this town, in this part of the United States and have this income bracket. It gets very specific. So they did a poll that determined that people who live in mixed neighborhoods have a lower rate of stereotyping and racism. Basically, people who are exposed to people from other cultures are less likely to fear them. So it's like a percentage. It's like 65% don't fear people from other cultures if they live in the environment. And then they did surveys of people who live in monoculture, meaning like a neighborhood that is only full of one, and they tend to have, you know, a higher rate of fearing people who are not from that culture. So the more the refugees come to the United States, the more even, not just refugees, doctors, like my father, the doctors, engineers come to the United States from the Arab and Muslim world, the more people will be exposed to something, a person that's not on television doing something radical, but somebody who's in your everyday life doing things that you're completely familiar with, such as music. Now, we also have dance in the Arab and Muslim world. A lot of dance, and men dance, and women dance. A lot of people would automatically think that Islam is a very conservative culture, so therefore people don't dance, or maybe they don't even laugh, okay? And the truth is we have tons of dance. So especially even in countries like Saudi Arabia, which is 99% Muslim, in Egypt, which is 86% Muslim, in Libya, in Morocco, for example, which is 78 or 82% Muslim, tons of people dancing all the time. And we have certain kinds of dances that involve props, certain types of dances that involve, you know, the isolation of the body, certain ones that involve like acrobatics and stuff. So I'm going to show you now one that comes from
I'm going to punish myself because I'm already sweating a lot. I'm going to sweat for you as all of you watch me. I'm going to do the one that is most familiar to me, which comes from Egypt, where I'm from, the south of Egypt, which is the dance of the Styx.
So first of all, we do not do them in suits. We do them in this outfit, which is actually a typical everyday outfit called, in classical Arabic, jalaba. In Egyptian Arabic, we call it galabeya. All the J's become a G sound in Egypt, sort of like our accent. Sort of like the Boston, you know, you drop the G at the end of the word, you know, sort of this thing. So here, first of all, it can be any color. They can be pink. They can be blue. They can be dark gray. And this one is dark gray. And this, the nice thing about it is if it's hot, you wear one. If it's cold, you wear two, three. And I'd like you all to know that we always wear something underneath it. Don't worry that like one of these guys is gonna flash you or something or cross their legs at the wrong moment. They all have pants underneath, so don't worry about that. Oh, and then we cover our heads too. It's really important to protect ourselves from the blazing sun of the South Shore of Massachusetts. So we have, for example, this hat. It's called a ta'eya, ta'eya. And this one, it's woven and covers the entire head. Then we have, well, I'm going to have to like juggle a little bit. So I need to be able to subdue my sleeves. So we have this, which is called wristband. Wristband. And then, even more so, or we might cover our head. I'm going to do this last because it's torture. All right, now,
we call this stick. In English. In Arabic, it's called asaya. Now, you, by saying asaya, you can learn three of the non-typical Arabic letters that don't exist in English language. The first one is ayn, so it goes ah. Can you say that, everyone? Ah. It's not third grade, we're all going ah. They all want to participate. You're just like, you know, is it 12 yet? Ah. Yes, exactly. So it's not ah, because if you said asaya, it means cruel woman. This is asaya, which means stick. So, ah, second letter is sa. We have two letter S's in Arabic. First one is s, like salad. Second one is sa. It's like you frown and the air is in your bottom lip. Sa. And then, yeah, asaya. Asaya, very good. Now, the asaya is a stick. Now, this is a reed that comes out of the Nile River. It's a solid bamboo. It's like bamboo, but solid. What we might call in English, rattan, I think. And the people from south of Egypt, who, you know, my generation probably doesn't really behave like this anymore, but use the stick for everything. For example, as extension of the hand, like pointing. Like, those two guys up there, they talk always. All right? So it's like for pointing, or like if emergency, that door, like that, okay? And then another thing is you get older, walk your way out. Something's on the road, chicken, lamb, can, push it away, somebody fights you. And then you defend yourself. Now all of this is turned into a dance. So whatever you see, is actually resembles things that could happen in the village life. So you may see, for example, the birds. Like this. You may see, for example, things that look like farming. It's not golfing. We don't golf. It's too expensive. You may see, for example, things that look like fighting. Okay? You may see, for example, rowing. You may see other things, like when you push, helping, pushing the ox. Okay? And then all the acrobatic stuff is very important. So like, oh,
But the whole time, I'm keeping this rhythm in the body. If I didn't have this rhythm, you just think, oh, crazy man with stick. But if I have it here, it looks like, oh, dancing man. So you see, I have this shoulder leaning, and then together. So then I'd have this beat. We have this famous beat in our body, in the music. It's called the Saidi beat. Saidi means like, it's an adjective for Southern Egyptian. So it goes like this. So I have this in my body the whole time. And then I start to do, huh, sweeping. I keep it in the body the whole time. Huh. Can go backwards, forwards, and then at some point, maybe my opponent has one stick. So I will have two asaya. I will tighten the pants, and then I'll, so much space. All right, here we go. So I have two, so I first keep the beat. Space bar. And then finally, and ha. All the time keeping the beat. And then when I'm ready to finish, then here, throw up, catch, and thank you. Thank you, everybody. So this is dance, but the thing about the Arabic style is it also looks like things. It looks like kind of the things that we would do in regular life, but in a fancy way. Now, I would also wrap my head. And this is the part that freaks out Americans the most. Even though baseball hats don't freak out people, this does. Men and women use this style. First of all, it's a kufiya, could be also solid color. There's so many ways to wrap the head. First of all, you could wrap your neck too to start off with. You put the triangle in the front, like this, and you go behind the head, and behind the head, like that, all right? Then the other way, just swooping straight down. This one's longer, and then like that, okay? Another way, straight up and down. This is the I just woke up. Just like that, okay? Now you tell me yes or no, Arabic style. Cold in Boston. Now, head. So you're going to see, this is one of those things we call the pan-Arabic, because you see it in, well, all the Arabic countries, which I've yet to name. Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Mauritania, Libya, Egypt, Sudan, Somalia, Djibouti, the Corfus Islands, Lebanon, Palestine, Jordan, Syria, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Oman, Qatar, Kuwait, the United Arab Emirates, and that's enough. Over 20. I usually can get 20. You'll see this all over. Couple of methods. First one looks just like the Magi and Jesus, Mary, and Joseph era. And we still do it in Saudi Arabia. So this is Saudi Arabian style, which is also nativity scene. Next time Christmas comes around, remember. Don't be afraid, it's just a hat. Now, another way, you know how people put baseball hats sideways? We kind of have style too. That. Okay, or even like, all right, many styles. Which one do we do? First, assess your mood. Now, this is, and I mean, if we had the multimedia presentation, which I don't feel is necessary because I have such colorful speaking style, but if we did, I would show you endless men who do this as well as women. Okay? And I would also show you them Eastern European women are doing it, and I would even show you various American women who do it. It's a headscarf. Head, scarf, together. Don't be afraid. Now, then we have things that would be also thought of as turbans. We do this a lot too. Start from behind, it's important. So I have most of it here, around, down, under, and through, okay?
Why do we wrap our head? Let's hear some explanations. Why would men or women in the desert, in one of the 22 plus territory countries that I mentioned, wrap their head?
The sun.
The sun, exactly. Sun's a killer.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Good. Anything else?
Sand.
Sand comes from everywhere. Sand can just come straight down at you. It's going to protect you from sand and sun. Anybody else? What about modesty? Many of these cultures, it's not typical to show skin in public. A lot of people think, well, this is a repression of freedom. They should be free to show whatever skin they want, right? And then they would come, you know, like my relatives would be like, why do all those women have to take off their clothes every time they want to go to the beach? So they would think of it in the reverse, which is like that these women are being repressed to must show skin, to must be a perfect size. So it's all just relative, okay? But in general, on our side of the world, basically, it's a little bit more, humble dressing, you know, to not so much show skin and not to give away too much of your appearance at that time. So that's just a cultural thing, not very typical in the United States, but it exists in many other places in the world. Like here, you know, that's how you can pick tourists out when you go all over the world, is like they're the ones that are wearing shorts. And talking like, let's go see that one, all right? Any question? Anybody else? Well, I'm going to now go over to music, melodic music. We're getting to the end. Do you have a question?
Yes,
yes, let's hear it.
I see the beautiful scarves that women have, and I can't believe me figure out how they stay on their heads.
Oh, yes. Because I've watched, you know, my mother doesn't wear it, but all my aunts and cousins wear it. It's a series of pins. Some of them are actually pre-constructed. It's almost like a sleeve that they put on top of their head, and then it's pinned on top of it as well. So some of them are actually constructed. There's like a whole fashion industry for it. So it's like a sleeve they put on, or other ones that lay on top. But there's like something foundational that they pin it to. And the wind and the sand comes and stays in perfect place and everything like that. Who here plays music? Who here is a musician? Who here has iPod? Who here likes music once in a while? Good. In order for the music to get into your iPod, a musician had to make it. And in the Arab world, we have a lot of instruments that don't exist in the United States. We have lutes, we have harps that we put on our lap, we have various flutes. But the most important thing that you're going to hear from all of these Arabic instruments is that they're tuned differently. So for example, sorry, were you able to hear this? Sorry.
It's submerged under my jalaba.
Now this one is one of the many different Arabic instruments. This is actually, the first time you would see it is in the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics. There's a very famous ancient Egyptian hieroglyphic that has three women playing three instruments. One is a flute, One is a harp, and one is this instrument, which used to be called a tanbur. And now it's called buzuk. But it's not famous in Egypt anymore. The buzuk is more famous in Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Palestine, and Iraq. This is the instrument for like a troub, almost like a troubadour style. But all the instruments have a system that doesn't exist in the United States. So for example, have any of you seen a piano? So look at the piano, black and white, black and white, black and white keys. So Arabic music, it has notes that are between those keys. That means that you cannot play Arabic music successfully on a Western instrument. You need an instrument where you can manipulate the pitch. I'll give you an easy example. So you know. So we have Mary Had a Little Lamb. Now if I changed one note, the third note, and played here, so here versus here, this is the two most common Western American music scales, major, minor. And look how we changed the life of Mary's lamb with that one note. I mean, Mary had a happy, uplifting, optimistic lamb. Mary had a depressed, therapy-needing lamb. All right? But now in the Arabic world, we have somewhere in between. So it's not here, but here. So this is halfway in between a white and a black key. And this is the most typical scale for all of Arabic music. So people would hear it and they maybe first, the first thing people, when they hear our music, well, they cringe, like your young lady's doing. I'm not even offended by it anymore. It's so typical. Is they say like, oh my God, they're out of tune. Let's help them. With everything, with our economy, with our government, all the above. Give us help. But with music, we may not need it, because this is our system. Is the music is unmeasured. It's in different frequencies, because it has not undergone this Bach and Beethoven-like homogenization that the Europeans have in order to be able to make the music playable by any instrument. We haven't undergone that. As a result, we have 22 notes. Per scale. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to sit on this very modern looking chair and I'm going to play for you what's called in Arabic taqsim. Taqsim, which means to divide. I'm going to take scales of music and I'm going to divide them in order to make a spontaneous improvisation. So we like to improvise in our music and our dancing and our behavior because it allows for some spontaneity. In music especially, it gives this experience of enchantment, intoxication when you improvise. It's much different than like say a composed Western music, which we also engage in sometimes as you know, when we want to have a foreign experience. But this is, you know, this is taqsim, which is in the Arabic style. So I'm going to go and play for you. Ooh, look at this, 70s. Just make sure I'm tuned. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. And if this was an Arabic audience, what would have happened is every time I did something interesting or I paused, you would have heard something from the audience. They would have said, Allah, which means God. Or they would have said, Ya Salam, which means I feel peaceful at this moment. Or they would have said, Ulf, which means like, please do that again, that was amazing. Or they would have said, Aywa, which means yes. So we have all these things where the audience would like participate with me, kind of like going to a comedy show and they say a joke and then you laugh. And that means, that tells the comedian that they were successful, that they killed it. If nobody laughed, it means that like he should try again or leave, right? So that's the same kind of thing with me. It's like, for me, when I do this process, it would be participatory, okay? So meaning like I would play something and then somebody in the audience would say something and then I know that I should continue and that I feel like I'm not in this by myself, all right? So that's part of also the process. So we're going to do one quick lesson of that, okay? Because I know you're not a very vocal group. I've noticed that. So
here's what's going to happen. You're going to say the word Allah. Can you say Allah?
Allah?
Now Allah, it means the God. That's all it is. It's not like a special Arabic or Muslim God. It's the same. And it also is not a religious statement in this case. It's kind of like if you hit a bicyclist, you went like, oh my God, you know what I mean? That it's kind of one of those situations where God, the word God is an exclamation as opposed to like a proclamation of belief, okay? So every time I pause, you're going to say Allah. And you can be creative. You don't like to say Allah like it's a sample on a button, like Allah, Allah, Allah. No, I want you to give it your sort of personality. So it could be like, repeat after me, Allah.
Allah.
Allah. Allah! Good. Now, all of this is what you would do whenever I pause, okay? So.
Allah.
Allah. Allah. That's such an exciting concert. The idea, all right? And that's how I would know, like, this is going well, they like my music, I should continue for the next 2 hours. Now, all of you have been a really, really excellent audience and really forgiving and nice. I want to thank Mary Rapien for inviting me here to the Bristol Community College Network, and for all of you coming here. Now there's one final instrument that I can show you all, and this is the instrument of celebration. We have a couple of words for this. In Egypt we call this tabla. Can you say tabla? Now the Indians get upset. It's like, that's not a tabla, all right? So, but the truth is that the tabla is an Arabic word that was brought to India by the Mughal Empire, and it literally means drum, and there are a lot of actually Arabic words in the Indian language. The tabla in India does not look like this, but it is a drum, and so that's the connection. Other parts of the Arabic world, we would call this darbeki. Can you say this? Darbeki. All right, darbeki. Means hit Becky. No, this means Darbeki. It means like the thing that tumbles. Okay? But it starts from the word darab, which means to strike. So to strike and tumble. And this instrument in America, in California, is called Dumbek. Nobody in the Arab world calls it Dumbek. But that's the word that ended up in all the catalogs. Because it was like, oh, Dumbek. Okay? So we don't call it that in the Arab world, but you're welcome to call it whatever you want after I leave. This is originally made from clay and the skin of a fish, but this is a new modern version. It's made completely from recycled aluminum cans. It's entirely recycled aluminum cans. Recycled x-ray film from the dentist's office. Okay, so it's wiped off. It's like all the ink that made the prints are all like washed off, and then that, and then it's used for it. And then all of this is what we call, yeah, it's called sadaf, which is actually mother of pearl. So this is the only valuable part, is actually the decoration, and which has nothing to do with the sound, but it just, you know, looks great. And so the whole instrument is a product of what I was talking about earlier, which is overpopulation, desertification, where there's very few resources left. So we're using a lot our garbage to make modern instruments as well. So we are recycling nations, the Arab world, not because a politician told us that it's going to save us in 100 years. No, because we have to do it now, because we don't have the other choice, because we're already deserted. So this tabla dirbeki, as a result, has the very high sound. And all the rhythms are made from dum and tek. Dum and tek. So this is the dum sound, this is the tek sound. So for example, then I have is, which is like no sound. So if I wanted to communicate a rhythm, I'd be like dums, steks, steks, dums, steks, stums, steks, steks, dums. And I would know that is. Or dums, dums, steks, dums, steks. So all of this is the verbal that comes to the music. And this is used for partying, for playing rhythm, for dancing, stomping, hoopla, and it's a party instrument. Unlike, you know, this ritual instrument, classical instrument, dancing sticks, cymbals, the buzuk, very different. This one is mainly for the party and being raucous and energetic and dancing. So here is an example. Could play different rhythms from around the Arab world, so you would get an idea of what they all sound like. So let's start all the way from the west, Morocco. Tunisia. Thank you very much for being in this presentation, for enjoying it with me. This is my chance to show you Arabic culture, things that you would come across in the Arabic-speaking Muslim world, the artistic things that don't get represented here in the United States, because it's not a political topic. Only the political topics get represented. Just like in the news, you know, it's nobody's fault, really. It's really the nature of the news, which is it tells you, like, you know, someone got shot on Main Street, you know what I mean? And this dog caught a disease, and this politician stole $1 billion. You know, they don't talk about, oh, this dog gave $1 billion. You know, they don't talk about positive things. That's the nature of the news. So, of course, whatever is talked about in the Arab world and Muslim world, it's all, you know, the controversial things and the things that makes people scared. So this is my chance to show you and make you familiar with everyday life that we endure and have, so that you see that we're also everyday people, and no need to be scared by the vast, vast, vast majority of us, which is exactly the same sentence you can say for every other ethnic group in this world. Okay? Thank you very much. And you don't seem like the question asking type. Does anyone have a question? 4, 3, 2. Thank you, everybody. See you again. Thank you.